Yeah, I was humbled yesterday as I went through the Da Vinci exhibit down the street. I don't know how many of you had a chance to look at that, particularly as an engineer, seeing all those ideas and that creativity. So it's kind of humbling as an engineer. But among all the various machines that they had models of there in the exhibit, I was surprised to find that Da Vinci developed a ditch digger. So I guess it's nice to know I have something in common in drainage work with Mr. Da Vinci. Thanks for the introduction, Natalie. You might be asking yourself, why are we concerned about designing drainage systems? Aren't all of our acres tiled out already in the Midwest and throughout the United States? Well, I'm here to tell you that there is a buzz, a big uptick in drainage activity, particularly where I work in Minnesota and in that region, but also throughout the upper Midwest. I think Matt would attest to the same kind of activity in Iowa and across the northern tier of Midwestern states. Sort of a perfect storm, you know, high land prices, high crop prices. Farmers are looking to make every acre as productive as possible. And so we're seeing a lot of drainage activity. And we're seeing, of course, many of these fields that had targeted drains historically are being put into pattern drains. And this is happening over and over and over again as you drive through the landscape now. You see the tile trucks everywhere. We're also seeing a lot of drainage in areas that did not traditionally have tile drainage. Of course, a lot of traditional drainage here in southern Minnesota, but in the Dakotas, and also in the Red River Valley area of North Dakota and Minnesota, and also up into Canada. There are a lot of poorly drained soils that relied historically on surface drainage alone that are now finding the practice of tile drainage to be a productive one. So a huge surge of activity. And so design, I think, comes back onto the table in terms of it's sort of our first level of defense after good agronomic practices is getting drainage systems in designed correctly. And we all know that there are any number of issues that are of concern when it comes to water management and drainage in particular. I'm not going to dig into these particular issues, but I think you're all aware of them. So obviously the text didn't come through here, so I'll have to recite it from memory, but I think I can do that. But our good colleague, Dr. Wayne Skaggs, coined the golden rule of drainage, I think, back in the 80s. And it does not start drain into others, but it starts drain only that amount which is absolutely necessary for good soil condition and crop growth, and not a drop more. And so guys like Dr. Helmers and myself and colleagues, we've been working very hard over the last 10, 15 years, 20 years, trying to help practitioners of drainage do just this. Okay, and so again, this is why design comes to the forefront here. And I've been using a figure like this in a lot of my extension talks for quite a long time to try to help practitioners understand that there's this sort of soft peak of profitability when it comes to drainage systems. And over time, I think practitioners have erred on the side of having more drains rather than less drains in the system, again, as a measure of sort of insurance, if you will. But what happens is that you have an environmental cost that has not traditionally been considered with these systems. So if we can find ways to help practitioners be over here and avoid this kind of environmental cost, be it drainage volume, nitrate loss, and so forth, then we're ahead of the game, and that's why design is important. The problem with this figure, though, is that it translates design into sort of one dimension, that is drainage spacing here. And there's more to drainage design than just simply drainage spacing. Although any of you that may be familiar with tile drainage design, we know that sort of an unlimited number of combinations of depth and drain spacing can give us one particular drainage design rate. We also know from work that's happened in Minnesota and Iowa, Illinois, and North Carolina that systems with different depth behave differently. Okay. And so it's important to put both of these items on the table when we approach drainage design. And so we could take that same curve now. We can generate a set of curves for every single drainage depth that we might be considering for design. So now the prospect of meeting this golden rule of drainage has become complicated for practitioners. So our idea was to try to develop some decision support for designers and practitioners of these systems to illustrate the effects of their design choices and to help them sort of meet this compromise between environmental impacts and profitability and productivity, which has been traditionally been the only goal of these systems pretty much. So we've taken a simulation approach based on our field data and the field data collected by others using a widely used model, DrainMod, looking at long-term simulations, benchmark soils in Minnesota at multiple locations so we can show the effects of climate in different soils. And then we use the outputs from our model to load a spreadsheet decision tool, again, to put in the hands of practitioners. And when we do that, when we look at drainage systems, and I've kind of mixed up units a little bit here as I go, so I apologize for that. But we can look at what we've done is then, for each soil and each location, we've got a range of drain spacings, a range of drainage depths, and we've bracketed our matrix of scenarios here by a high and low drainage rate that sort of fall within the traditional water removal rates for these systems. This would be about a half inch a day. This would be about a quarter of an inch a day for our drainage systems. And when you run those through a model, you end up with any number of outputs, crop yield, drainage volume, surface runoff volume. But each one of those outputs really is a response surface, if you will. And this golden rule of drainage, then we'd be asking designers and practitioners to somehow negotiate through these multiple response surfaces and come up with a great design that minimizes environmental impacts and maximizes productivity. That's a tall order. That's a tall order without some help. So the objectives that a designer might have would be certainly the traditional objective of maximizing productivity. That goes without say. We'd like to see minimize environmental effects, drainage volume, nitrate losses, and so forth. But with a little bit more difficulty, what we want to help them do is look for opportunities within those response surfaces to reduce environmental effects without paying too dearly on the profitability standpoint, or conversely, look for opportunities within those response surfaces, those design scenarios, to increase profitability without paying too dearly on the environmental standpoint. So these are the sort of compromises that I think the golden rule embodies that they're going to need some help doing. And so we've developed a spreadsheet tool, again, loaded with output from our model, and we're sort of just testing this now and taking it out for an initial spin. But we pull the output from DrainMod in there and then build an interface that designers and farmers will be able to put in some of their own data, select a location, select a soil, and then see how things look in terms of design choices. And I've got some output from that just to give you some examples. So we standardized the outputs here, and the curves aren't showing up too well, but at least the dots are showing up. We standardized the output, so here is this would be, in terms of profitability, the least profitable scenarios. You see the different drainage depths here, and we get more and more profitability based on internal rate of return as we get deeper and wider. And there's some reasons for that. The cost of the system factors in. A drainage system that gets put in deeper and farther apart needs less pipe in the field, so that influences the cost and so forth. So we've got profitability, standardized profitability, and that actually would be a response surface. We've got drainage volume or nitrate loss, and you see how that relates to drain spacing and drain depth. And then we have surface runoff, and these are three examples of output from the model that are built into this design tool. So thinking about those and then helping practitioners sort of negotiate among all of these choices, we developed a couple of indexes to collapse these set of curves or response surfaces, if you will, to a single number. And I'm just calling it index number one, which embodies profitability over that first output, which is drainage volume, or it could be nitrate loss. So the idea for the practitioner would be to maximize this index either by improving profitability or reducing the environmental impact, but not doing one disproportionately with the other. Then the second index would embody all three of these outputs using the environmental variables of runoff and drainage in the denominator with profitability on top. And so then if we look at the first, it collapses those two parameters down to a single one, And the practitioner would look at this and say, okay then. Well, if I'm looking at drain spacings in this range, there's really not too much of an incentive for me to go deeper, shallower. All those depths sort of collapse onto one curve. But I could improve this index, that is, either improve profitability or reduce my environmental impact by going still wider, okay, still wider and deeper. So again, we're trying to boil it down and make it a more simple approach for the practitioner. Now, if I show the index which embodies all three of these outputs, what do you think it's going to look like? Take a peek at the, it's very hard to see, but you see the surface runoff and the subsurface runoff, they're sort of go opposite to one another. As we increase subsurface drainage, we tend to reduce surface runoff and vice versa. If we throw those into one index, now the curves look like this. They're sort of flat. And if we are approaching environmental impacts with a very general eye, our work becomes harder. Our work becomes harder. And so as you would look at this index now, you would say, okay, well, I can improve this index, that is, increasing profitability while not adversely impacting the environment by going deeper. The deeper indices perform better. But in terms of drain spacing, there really is no guidance there. One is as good as another. So anyway, we're taking this out for a spin and trying to reduce down a system of complex decisions into something that is a little more manageable. Taking a bit of a turn now, we're doing some other things with DrainMod. I mentioned there have been an increase in drainage in areas that haven't traditionally relied on the practice. The Red River Valley of Minnesota and North Dakota, I don't know how many of you might be familiar with that system. It's an extremely flat, low gradient system. It's one of the flattest places I've ever seen. The folks that live there say you can watch a dog run away for 2 days. That's how flat it is. But the interesting thing hydrologically about that system is that, you know, water flows to the north. It's frozen up north at the time it's thawing in the south, and so you have sort of a natural logjam in the system. It's a very, very interesting area, and it's very, very prone to flooding, spring flooding. And the outlook for this year is grim with all the snow and cold we've had. But they are very, very concerned about what's going on here in late March and early April. And with this uptick in tile drainage, you know, decision makers, local government folks are saying, gosh, are we going to be worse off or are we going to be better off with all this tiling? And so our work is trying to help, again, with some of the guidance there. And we're digging into the daily output of DrainMod, something that's not typically been done in much of the DrainMod modeling work. And so this is just an illustration of that for one particular soil, one location here. This is the average year, the statistical average year, daily flows. So these are daily flows based on a 100-year record. So if you're able to look at all the daily flows over 100 years and plot out that statistically average year, this is what it would look like with a 90% confidence interval in lighter tones here. And so you can see this first plot here is surface runoff with no tile drainage. Then we can add tile drainage to the system, and here is the tile drainage flow. Again, the statistical 100-year flow for tile drainage. Here's the surface runoff after the introduction of tile drainage to that same soil at that same location. And so what the flood control folks are worried about is the sum total of all the flows. So if we put these now surface flows together with the tile drainage flows that we just had, now this is the total water that the river's going to receive. Now, again, this is a field scale. You'd have to sort of extrapolate up to larger scales. If you add these two curves together and compare those to the previous flows without drainage, now you can start to see where the red pokes up here above the black. Those are where we might expect to have more water at a certain time of the year with drainage compared to the scenario without drainage. Now we can start to look at the timing here and begin to understand if that's going to be a problem or a blessing for the folks in that area. We can look at other soils. This is just a cumulative plot of the same soils. Again, going over a statistical year based on 100 years. We can see where the pre-drainage water yield, which is all surface runoff, and the post-drainage water yield start to diverge here. It's, after March into April, which is a very, very important time of the year for them. This is another soil that looks a little bit more challenging in terms of more water here when we compare the pre- and the post-drainage scenarios. And again, this is the cumulative plots for that particular soil. So we're looking at a number of soils, a number of locations to try to help them understand how their system might behave. We can plot these on a weekly basis as well. We've got a little bit less noise, and it's a little easier to see what's going on here. Again, comparing the post-drainage, post-tile drainage in the red with the pre and the black here. For that second soil, we have like this. So flags are going up when they see this kind of thing. And we need to do our homework to see if those are, if our modeling output is really representative. So in summary, let me say that investments in agricultural drainage, certainly in the upper Midwest, are likely to continue as we see what's going on with land prices, crop prices, and so forth. We're going to see a lot more drainage activity on the landscape. And I firmly believe that opportunities do exist to meet that golden rule of drainage and address environmental goals at the same time we meet those traditional profitability goals. Achieving these goals, though, is going to require some guidance because it is a complicated system, and it's going to be difficult to negotiate that without some help. And I think more work is required, and I know if I asked Matt, he would agree with this. I think that we need more work to know that our models are doing a good job of modeling the crop and the ET response. The big part of the water budget is ET, the water that goes back up into the sky. And we're talking about changes in the water balance that are very, a very small fraction of the total balance. And so we need to be really sure that our models are really accurately depicting these sort of before and post drainage scenarios. And so more work to do there. Natalie? Yes. Well, the question was, is there any different consideration of depth based on different crops like alfalfa and so forth? And the consideration of depth, actually, everything is on the table. You need to think about, you know, what crop you're growing, what does the soil profile look like, and are there layers that would push you to be shallower than deeper? What's going on with the outlet? You know, if outlets are challenging, sometimes that boils down to a decision on depth. And so all of those things come into play. And so this discussion is sort of, the premise here is that if you've got some wiggle room, if you will, in terms of depth, how would we incorporate that into design? But yes, it does factor in as we look at different crops and so forth. Well, actually, yeah, we did use a graduate student to automate the process. So we had a lot of drain mud. For that first sort of suite of runs, we had, I think, about six soils and three locations. And the depth and spacing combinations, I think that was about 20, 21 runs per soil location combination. So it blows up pretty large. So there are some tools with DrainMod where you can build on kind of a front end to automate this, and we take advantage of those. Because it is a lot of information to manage. Okay.